Hi, good morning. Okay, so we'll start, right? Okay, how many of you think the large-scale distributed system would be easy? Can you raise your hands? No? Okay. So I have listed some rules we should follow to deploy a large-scale distributed system. But if you follow these rules, I would say that this large-scale distributed system is going to be very easy to deploy in production. So let's look at what are these rules. And so I will explain some stories behind some of these rules. And so we'll discuss telling stories kind of session. So we'll go to that. OK, so these are the some of these rules. This came from my mind while preparing the presentation. There may be other rules, so this is not exactly rules, but this is some rules I came to my mind, so I will discuss with this presentation. Number one, make the service scale. So what do you mean by service scale? And if you want to host a cloud application, so you need to make your cloud application scaling. So you need to make sure your architecture supports that scaling. So what do you mean by scaling? You may need to double your server, you may need to triple your server, you may need to add maybe 10 servers for same application or 100 of servers for application. So for doing that, you can't do a normal application to run in a cloud without doing a proper architecture. But so saying the proper architecture means, another important thing is make your application very simple. Why would I say that? So when you think about distributed application, you may think, okay, fancy technology like distributed caching, distributed locking. So we need to use this kind of technology to develop your application. So that's not necessary. If you want to really need that technology, use it. Otherwise, don't use them. But this technology is not scaled thousands, maybe a 10,000s kind of scalable. So this application are only tested around 10 or 20 servers kind of thing. These theories are going to break, definitely will break in 1,000 or 10,000 of deployment. So if you want to make it scale, make it simple. For example, another thing is, say if you want to do some caching, make it separate. Don't bundle into application. Make a separate layer. That caching layer may be scale, your application may be scaled separately. So that's all the things you need to make sure that you are designing your architecture. For example, if you look at how Google scaling their application is very simple. So when you, all of you are using Gmail or maybe Google Doc, so when you log into your Gmail, from Google data centers, they will create a container for your application. It's create one-to-one container. So my application get one container, your application get another container. So my whole application in one container. There's no horizontal multiple containers for my application. So it will create a, for example, if you get a Google Gmail, so it will create a front-end container and a back-end container. And make it a group and deploy the same host machine. And say if you want to do a search query in the Gmail, so you need to get more resources to that to your application. So normally what we are thinking, okay, we can do this horizontal scaling, but Google are doing other way around. They're doing vertical scaling. How they are doing it? So they will kill your container and create another container with more resources, because you are requesting more resources to do the search query, adding more memory, adding more CPU. Even you are not noticed that in your browser. So because containers can start up in milliseconds, even previous one is destroyed, new one is created, you are serving the same request without any delay or without any break. So they are very simple. There's no fancy session replications, no distributed locking or distributed caching. Just one application running simply with their data. So that's why they can deploy large scale in millions of kind of distributed application. So make sure you can make your simple as possible your application if you want to deploy a large scale. Next thing, make the deployment consistent. What do you mean consistent? Say if you have five servers of your application, now you want to provision a new server. So how do you can provision? You can create a startup instance, you can configure it, you can do the all the setting up things, and you can join to the cluster. But if the new servers not consistent with the others, your cluster going to be a break. Then you are hitting a oops moment. So if you want to do large scale deployment, you have to make all consistent across all the clusters. So how you can do that? So you can use Puppet, Chef, or Sol kind of conversation language. So these tools get use of these tools to your deployment. So I think Chamit will talk about in next sessions how you can use this technology. But you have to think about, you have to think all the deployment consistent across the clusters if you want to do the scaling. The other concept is like you can use immutable server concept. So this is not new, but I will explain what is the immutable server. So for example, say if you are releasing software, if you are deploying a release into the cloud, you can configure it your operating system, and you can install the dependence OS libraries, dependent software libraries, and configure your application, and all things are within the OS container or server. Then you can test this server with your test cases. Then you can make sure 100% this server is working with this version. And after that, don't do any simple changes to that server. So make it immutable and deploy it into the production. Then there's all thing we know that we have tested all the test cases is passed and is running now. If you want to do a new release into the production, create another server with all the dependencies, OS dependencies, all software dependencies, make it test with all the test cases, make it sure it's working 100%, and deploy a new server and discard the previous one to the traffic route in the new server. This is the immutable server concept. So this is very important. Say the newest version, maybe application has some bug with the scaling, so you need to roll back. So simply, you know that, okay, if you think about the last rollback version, that is all bundled with the OS components, library components, and if we tested 100% is working, you just roll back to that version. If you don't have that capability, and if you upgrade your existing server to new version, and when you're going to rollbacking, it's very nightmare. So when you're going to rollback, you may need to do the schema changes. You need to downgrade the OS library components. So that can't do in practically. That makes a lot of trouble to you. So make your life simple. So make your production deployment immutable servers, and you can roll back easily to the workable state without any hassle. So with this new technologies, Docker containerization, so you can easily do this immutable server or immutable container concept. So how you can do that? So in the Docker container, you are burning all the configuration, all the libraries, and all the stuff with the required to the software, and make it an immutable container. You can spin up an instance out of that, or you can roll back to the workable state very little time, so because container startup time is very minimum. And I forgot one thing in the consistent thing. So this again, another thing is, say you have DevOps role, right? So DevOps means development and the ops role. So in the development side, the application can develop within your machine. You are tested within a local machine, you tested with the servers up and running in local hosts and doing some testing, and then you are passing that into the QA. Then they have their own environment with some couple of machines. They are doing their testing against their environment. Then the pass, if they pass, then product software is going to be ops team. Then they deploy to staging with their hardened environment, and they are doing testing. If you think about developer doing testing different environment, QA doing testing different environment, now ops guys testing different environment, then you deploy into production, it is in different another environment. So things can be break if you have not consistency for all these across these stages. So how you can do this consistent across this all the life cycle of the software development stages? So again, we can use a technology like Docker. Say, if you use Docker into a development life cycle, you can create a Docker file for your development. So that means you are testing against the all full bundle image. Excuse me. So developer then developing using the same image can be pushed to the QA environment without doing single change. They can deploy the same Docker image into the QA environment. They are doing the scalable testing. After they are doing testing, the same image can be passed to the staging. Then same image can be passed to the production. So if you use this kind of concept, you know that all this your application are tested across the, all the life cycle with very consistent state. So that make very simple, that makes sure you are application running in production, even developer using same stage, same environment, same state of the application. So it your ops life is very easy because when your bug arise, even developer can identify the same environment in developer environment. So that's another very good thinking. If you want to deploy a cloud application, make the consistent across the, all the life cycle of the software development. OK, other important thing is understand all the layers of system. So if you can't understand all the layers of system, don't deploy in production. Don't make your application, treat your application as a black box. So this is a common mistake ops guys are doing because they treat, OK, this is not our job. So this is developer application developer job. They need to understand all the technologies. We are just deploying in the production servers and make the network up and running. So that's wrong. So you can't debug. You can't identify any issues if you don't understand all the layers of the application. Say if your application are using a database, then you need to identify, OK, what are the, say if your application are not performing, you need to identify, OK, why is this application not performing? Due to the network latency or due to the application logic or maybe due to the database calls that are running in, underneath in the application. If you don't know this all this technology, you can't identify the issue. So if whenever production issues comes, you are going to panic mode. So because you don't know what's the technology used in this application. So make sure you understand all the technology that used in your application. OK. Other thing is monitor everything. This is very important. So if you want to deploy a cloud application, you have to monitor everything. What do you mean everything? OK, so make your monitoring place that, OK, my server's up and running. OK, that's good. You know that service up and running. But that's not enough. And then you have to think about, OK, how many load come into the servers? How many requests come into servers? How many requests serve from the servers? OK, that's again good, but not enough. You need to do other monitoring, right? How many network calls calling from the application? How many database calls calling from the application? Whether your switch is working properly with the load? Whether the routing is happening properly with that latency? So you need to do all the monitoring across the stack to make the application very productively running in the production. So place your all the monitoring stuff in your deployment. And in the DevOps, the dev cycle, you please put your monitoring stuff into your code. So for example, if you're doing some database calls, make some log file. You can disable it in production, but it should be on off kind of thing. Make a saying that, OK, this time I will call my database, and this time I will return the database output. So when the some issues happen in the production, ops guy should be monitor that into log file and see, OK, this server is getting a lot of database queries and a lot of database latency happening inside the, with the system. So unit system guy should be identified, OK, I need to scale the database layer. So to identify that, you have to monitor them. So if you don't put this monitoring, you can't think about, OK, what's wrong with my application. You have to scale all the stuff in the application. That's not necessary. If you put your monitoring in the real places, you can identify, OK, because of this, this is going to hit the performance. You can increase that servers into that maybe a software database layer. You can increase the database performance. So if you, in the dev cycle, please put your monitoring code in your code. So that make easier life in the, when you go into operations. OK. Next one is the plan for the failures. This is, again, very common mistake we are doing. So whenever we are in the application developers doing, they are doing the happy path. OK, they're saying, OK, my database service running. OK, my caching service running. And if you click this, and it will working fine. Then they push to the ops guys, OK, I have developed a new feature. I have tested my machine. Please put it into production. So you can't do, don't put in production if you are not planned for the failures. Down the database and see how is application behaving. And down the caching layer, see and see what is meant by the application. So you need to, these things happening in production. And you are thinking, OK, you are deploying in Amazon EC2, there's no failure in my servers. No, these things happen. You can't guarantee 100% uptime to any software services in the world. So make sure you have plan for the failures. So other important thing is break thing under control condition. Say if you have application having a database layer, and what happen if the database layer perform very badly to the application? So how can you test that? For the simple one example, one way of doing our experiences. So if you use a Linux servers and if you're running some MySQL or database in that Linux servers, you can do simulate this load disk performing by doing the man search in the cron job. So you do the disk IO, heavy disk IO, then run the database. Then database going to be badly performing and in effect to the application. So you can place in this kind of testing before you go into the production and see what how behavior the application in the production. So plan these things in before going to the production. When you go to production, when this happens, then the oops movement, then you have to deal with the production data and production uptime. Okay, so if you are deploying cloud application, don't deploy a single server. At least you have to deploy two servers. Why is that? Maybe power failure, maybe server breaks. So you can't guarantee it, even Amazon EC2, you can't guarantee it, your server is up and running 100%. With my last 10 years experience in the Amazon, I have come across many cases. My servers are down, my servers are getting IO errors, my servers are getting network errors. That is the reality. You can't guarantee even this large kind of IaaS deployment, these things happen. So you have to make sure at least two servers running to make the one server's down, other servers are need to be up and running for the availability. Again, now we have two servers cluster, even that not enough. So maybe a data center power may be down, or maybe the rack server power down. So that's destroy you all the cluster. So this also happened in Amazon. Amazon data centers may be down some cases. So we can't guarantee this stuff. So you have to plan if you want to have more nines. So Amila will talk about is how to get more nines. So you can have to plan this stuff in your application deploy in production to how you can get more nines availability with this kind of concept. So deploy redundant clusters. So it may be a across the multiple data centers, across the multiple service providers. So that gives you the more high availability. Then we have to route this request to the nearest location. So to do that, we may use your DNS or Anycast kind of technology. How many of you heard of Anycast? Not much, right? So Anycast is very cool technology. It's not new one. So it's like it uses the same address. For example, if you look at the Google DNS server, you know 8888 is a DNS server. It uses Anycast. So this DNS server deployed across the globe, maybe more than 1,000 servers. So how can they do is that? So same IP address in 1,000, duplicating 1,000 servers. So they will inject the routers in the ISP routers to do the Anycast routing with the nearest location with the same IP address. So that's how Anycast working. So if you want to deploy a large scale deployment with the multiple across the globe, maybe best case with the use Anycast. Okay, this again, never deploy your poor written code into the cloud. Don't do it. So if you deploy your poor written code, your data center again going to be a crash. So for example, this is a common mistake we are again doing. So developer testing with their own machine, okay, he may come across some bugs on some one and there, so he said, okay, this is a rare bug, so I don't want to fix this, so I will deploy it to the production. So if the in the production case, it happened in if you scale in 1,000 or million times, it happened maybe tomorrow, maybe today, maybe this hour, because with the high scale, your bugs will be hitting very fast. So don't deploy poorly written code into the cloud. Even if your management push, don't do it. As ops people, try to defend that, okay, you can't up and run in these services if you deploy this poorly written code into the production. Next thing is load balancing is critical. So if you want to deploy multiple servers, you have to route the request, right? Then you have to do the load balancing. So place your load balancers, necessary places, and do the load balancing across the your application. So my time is running fast. I will go next one. Okay, restoring. Restoring means like she's spelling strong here. So I didn't put backup in my slide. Why I didn't put backup? So the other thing is people are doing mistake is, okay, I'm taking backup, I'm safe. You are not. I'm saying 100% guaranteed that your backup are not working when you're going to restore. How many you have tried to restore your backup? How many times you tried? You are not, right? So we are keeping our mind safe, say that, okay, I have a backup, I can restore, so I'm safe in my operation. That's not. So, and even some of us saying that, okay, I am doing the replicas, I have the replicas, so I'm safe. No, that's again wrong. So again, I can tell a story. So in 2011, you may heard about that Google Gmail has an outage. So it is not a service unavailable outage, it's like, where is my account? Account are lost, all data is lost. So what happened in that case, they have a bug in their replication software. They have two copies of replicas, empty replicas. So all the data is having, all the servers have in the empty files with the replication bugs inside their code. So when they realize they don't have the data, but they have the backup with their tape drives. They restore all the data. They took it took two days to restore all terabyte of data, but they restored all the data since because they had the tape backup in their system. So backup it is important even if you have the replication controllers in your system. So and again, backup it not enough. You have to try the restoring. So restoring, you have to, at least you have to try to restore your one portion of data regularly, maybe weekly, and see whether it's working properly. Okay, the final thing, if you can't automate, don't deploy it in production. It's very important. So for example, so last year we had virtual hackathon event across the globe. For that, it's a big data event. So for that, we have to deploy our software across the 100 EC2 instances. And we deploy 10 Kubernetes clusters across these 100 instances. And we deployed more than 500 Docker containers across these 100 instances. So this is our setup. So then, so it is a 24-hour event. So we, for that, we didn't have the staging environment, so we just used a production environment. And within the 24 hours, we after starting 10 minutes, some of our code enable the debugging. It will every 10 seconds it will print to the disk to all the topology information. Disks are filling up very fastly. Within 15 minutes, it's filled 1 terabyte of data. So we can't handle it. When we shut down all the servers and we recreate our environment within the 10 minutes, because of we have all the automation, automation scripts are placed in the environment. Otherwise, within 24-hour event, we can't make it happen. So even the simple thing, please do automation. You can't. So that is your ops and the DevOps lives make easier. So make your things automate. So these are the stuff what I want to talk today. So if you follow these kind of rules, I would say your distributed scale application going to be easy to manage. So it's matter of following these kind of rules, then you can be a, the DevOps side going to be very easy.